And we are live.
Welcome to iFocus Lecture 41. Today we have Dr. Tuleha Chauhan, who is currently working as a consultant in cornea, cataract and refractive services at Center for Sight, New Delhi. She has done her fellowship in cornea and refractive surgery from Stena Institute, University of California, and also fellowship in cornea and external diseases from MEI, Harvard University. She has various publications in high-index journals. She is also the current fellowship coordinator at CFS, and so we see her name often in our inboxes these days. So we are very happy to have you with us today, ma'am. Welcome, and over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Harika. And I would like to thank iFocus for giving me this opportunity today. So shall I share my screen here? So I hope my screen is visible to all.
Yes, ma'am. Perfect.
Okay, fine. So I have been given this topic of corneal and conjunctival degeneration. So it is a very important clinical topic because we see such patient in our day-to-day clinical practice. There are many corneal conjunctival degeneration which are given in literature, but we are going to discuss quite a few here which are clinically very significant for us and which affect our diagnosis and the patient visual requirement. So, just a moment, yeah. So what does degeneration mean? Oxford says it's the state or the process of being or becoming degenerate, decline, or deterioration. Every term means it's a progressive in nature. So the degeneration in a real sense is a progressive process. So in this today's talk, we're going to focus on the degeneration versus dystrophy, that how to differentiate clinically degeneration from dystrophies, what constitutes normal aging of the cornea, and making a spot diagnosis for the residents, like what are the telltale signs of various degenerations, systemic history and tailored investigations, and the management for the same. So corneal conjunctival degeneration refers to the condition in which normal cornea and conjunctival cell undergo degenerative changes under the influence of age or pathology. So the progressive nature of the tissue changes causes deterioration and may impair the function. The characteristic finding for any degenerations are, they are usually unilateral, they are asymmetric, and the peripheral. It is not a universal rule, but maximum degeneration are unilateral, asymmetric, and peripheral. And the degeneration result in deposition in the cornea and conjunctiva, thinning of the cornea, vascularization of the cornea, and sometimes inflammation associated with these degenerations. So we'll discuss corneal degeneration here first. And there are many corneal degeneration, but we are covering few which we are seeing in our clinical practice. So it is classified on the basis of age-related degeneration and the pathological degeneration. So we are going to discuss all this degeneration in today's class. First of all, the difference between dystrophies and degeneration. It is very important to differentiate these two conditions in clinical practice. So I think all the classes on dystrophies are already done. So you guys know everything about dystrophies, but this is like a small table just to differentiate these two conditions. Dystrophies are usually bilateral. Degenerations can be unilateral or bilateral. Dystrophies are pretty symmetrical process and degenerations are asymmetrical. Dystrophies can occur in early ages. I'm not saying that it is only occurring in early age or young adult. It can occur in old ages also. For example, Fuchs corneal dystrophy. But usually dystrophies are young adult condition. Degeneration usually occur with age and it is a late condition. Family history are usually positive in dystrophies, which is not positive in degeneration. Sight is like central cornea is affected in dystrophy, and in degeneration, peripheral cornea is affected. Vascularization is absent in case of dystrophies, but it is a well-known feature of degeneration. And inflammation usually absent, but degeneration can be associated with inflammation. So what do you mean by aging cornea? As we are discussing degeneration and we discussed that degeneration happens with age. So what happens when the cornea ages? So there's a change in the shape and the optical properties. And these are the clinical changes which will happen when we age. There's a steepening of keratometry and a shift from with the rule to against the rule astigmatism. Transparency is unaffected in the central cornea in the absence of any scarring or degeneration usually. The collagen intramolecular and interfibrillar spacing increases, possibly via increased protein glycation with the age. Increased thickness of desmoid membrane. Endothelial cell loss is a common process with aging. It is around 0.6% per year with concomitant increase in polymegathism and pleomorphism. So there's a flattening of vertical meridian and there's a steepening of horizontal meridian. That's how the with the rule is converting into against the rule. Thinning at the periphery happens with age and there's an increased visibility of the corneal nerves with age. There are certain physical properties of the eye which changes with age. These are resistant to infection reduced, failure to upregulate ICAM1 and reduce inflammatory cell infiltration, reduce phagocytic active cell after infection, decline in the high energy metabolism, increased tear contact time, and increased epithelial permeability to fluorescein. So let's discuss the most common degeneration which we see in our day-to-day practice is called arcus senilis. It is also called gerontoxin or arcus lipoides. It is an annular lipid infiltration on the periphery and the kind of lipid will deposit is phospholipid and cholesterol. It starts in the superior and inferior quadrant usually and it progresses circumferentially forming a ring which is opaque, white, gray or blue ring. It is around 1 millimeter wide. It can be wider than this, but usually the common finding is around 1 millimeter wide ring. So it is the telltale sign of arcus senilis are the peripheral border is sharp and the central border is very diffuse. There's a clear zone, which is called lucid interval of Vogt, which is fine. You can observe it in a very dense arcus. The level of deposits are desmoid membrane, Bowman's zone, and the peripheral stroma. So very important thing about arcus senilis is that it is visually not significant. But if there's a dense arcus and with a broad arcus, if you're doing a surgery in such patient, the visibility of a surgeon is affected in such cases. So it is very important to assess this degeneration in your clinical practice. Usually it is present in above 60 years old people and almost all above 80 years have mild to severe arcus senilis. What is the clinical significance? If this degeneration happens before the age of 40 years, it is not a normal process. Usually young adult who present with arcus, it is called arcus juvenilis. It's a very rare condition and it has an association with hyperlipoproteinemia type 1 and 2 and coronary heart disease. So when you find somebody who is less than 40 years with the arcus juvenilis, it's very important to send that patient for the systemic examination to rule out any life-threatening condition. Another very common degeneration which we find, it's Vogt white limbal girdle. It is usually bilateral, is chalky white deposits. It is found in the interpalpebral area and the level of deposits are at the Bowman's level. 60% of the people are above 40 years and it has a female predilection. There are two types of girdles, which are, the type one is called, it has a Swiss cheese hole pattern, which looks like the Swiss cheese here. And there's no distinct area between the lesion and the limbus, if you can see in this picture. And it is a less prevalent type of girdle. The type two, there is no holes. It's a clear juxtalimbal zone and it is more prevalent. Very important crocodile chagrin. It is again a very common degeneration which we see in our clinical practice. It is usually bilateral symmetric. It's a gray-white polygonal opacities. Intervening clear spaces are always present. And it can be central, it can be peripheral, though the peripheral type of crocodile chagrin is more common than the central one. And the deposits are more in an anterior stroma rather than posterior corneal stroma. This is visually insignificant degeneration, but why it is important? Because we have to differentiate it from dystrophy of Francoi, which looks like this, but it has a visual significance. So we have to differentiate whether it is a Cockerell-Chagrin degeneration or it's a dystrophy. So it's very important to rule out. So why it is called Cockerell-Chagrin? Because it looks like a skin of the crocodile, which is there in the picture. Another thing is Hasselhalle body or the warts. It's very important for the examination point of view because these kind of questions can come in your spot diagnosis. So it's a hyaline-filled excrescences of desmoid membrane. It is usually present in peripheral cornea. It's associated with normal aging. It's again a senile degeneration. What happens in Hasselhalle bodies? There's a dysfunctional overproduction of hyaline basement membrane by endothelial cells. And this condition is very well diagnosed through specular reflection or specular microscopy. Cornea farinata is again bilateral. It's a minute flour-like deposit. It's a gray-brown to white in color, visually insignificant. Why it is important to diagnose cornea farinata? Because it comes into the differential diagnosis of vortex keratopathy. And we all know that vortex keratopathy is because of the drug-induced or the toxin-induced. So if we are not diagnosing this, we might miss the diagnosis of vortex keratopathy as well. So it's very important to know that these deposits, what we find in the cornea, they are not because of any toxins or drugs, and they are just because the aging process. Another differential diagnosis for cornea farinata, which we can get confused with, is a Lisch corneal dystrophy. So we should differentiate these three diagnoses when we see this minute flour-like deposits in the cornea. Now let's come to the pathological degeneration, because as we discussed, the senile degeneration are usually benign. They are not visually very significant and they are just there and you don't have to do anything for this. No treatment is required. You can manage patient on conservative treatment. But when the pathological degeneration came into the picture, usually patients are very symptomatic and you need to treat them. So we are going to discuss some common pathological degeneration which we see in our clinical practice. And the first one is the band-shaped keratopathy. So band-shaped keratopathy is again because of deposits of calcium in a form of calcium hydroxyapatite deposition. And the deposition are always usually at the Bowman's level and deep layer of epithelium and superficial stroma. These are the fine dust-like basophilic deposits in the Bowman's layer, first seen peripherally with the lucid interval, we can see in the picture. And then eventually the deposit may coalesce to form a horizontal band of dense calcific plaques across the interpalpal zone of the cornea, like this. So when they cover the visual axis, they become visually significant. Usually, how band-shaped keratopathy happen? So there are two ways, like there's a primary, which the reason is usually idiopathic. We see the patient and there is no reason we can relate band-shaped keratopathy with. So it's an idiopathic reason, which is really not very common. It is a rare type when the primary idiopathic thing is very rare. The most common band-shaped keratopathy is usually secondary, which happens secondary to ocular disorders or the systemic disease. So what are the ocular condition which give rise to band-shaped keratopathy? They are a chronic condition which give rise to the band-shaped keratopathy because of the bad ocular surface. These diseases which affect the ocular surface results in band-shaped keratopathy. For example, chronic condition like uveitis, interstitial keratitis, severe superficial keratitis, chemical injury, and thesis bulbi. These are the condition which are chronic in nature and give rise to band-shaped keratopathy. There are various systemic conditions which are responsible for this kind of degeneration. For example, hypercalcemia, in hyperparathyroidism, vitamin D toxicity, milk alkaline syndrome, or sarcoidosis. It can be hereditary transmission, for example, familial band keratopathy. Elevated serum phosphorus with normal serum calcium in patient with a renal failure can give band-shaped keratopathy. Chronic exposure to mercurial vapor or to mercurial preservatives, for example, phenyl mercuric nitrate or acetate in ophthalmic medication. The mercury causes changes in corneal collagen that result in deposition of the calcium. Silicon oil is a very, very common reason for Banship keratopathy. And when we put it in the aphakic eye, usually they end up having Banship keratopathy in chronic. It's a chronic condition. So these are the various picture of Banship keratopathy. It's a different type. For example, the first picture showing peripheral, not visually significant, BSK. The another picture is a central visual axis involved. It usually results in glare and reduced vision since it is a rough ocular surface. And the third is a dense central band, which is visually significant. And if you can see the change in the color from B, the picture B to C. So when the that band is getting denser, you can see the secondary changes are happening, like pigmentary deposits are also happening on this dense band. So it is visually more significant. And the last but not the least, it is the painful recurrent corneal erosion like symptoms which predisposes to ulceration. And this is like a very dense deposit which will patient is suffering from recurrent corneal erosion and patient is very symptomatic. So the management part, the very important thing when we are treating lesions or deposits in the cornea is to know what is the depth of the lesion. Because until and unless we don't know the depth of the lesion, we cannot decide the treatment. So anterior segment ocular coherence tomography is the best tool to know the depth of the corneal lesion. So in case of band-shaped keratopathy, we can see this hyper-reflective material around Bowman's layer causing shadowing in the posterior stroma. So if you see, the top layer is the epithelium and the below epithelium, you can see this kind of deposits. And these deposits are so dense that you can see this dark area. This is called shadowing effect. This might have covered in the ASOCT lecture already. Yeah, so this, because of this dense band, we are getting this shadowing. And we know where the deposits are in on ASOCT. So as we discussed that band-shaped keratopathy is very common, secondary type is very, very common. So whenever we find some patient with band-shaped keratopathy, we should always go for the systemic workup. We should treat the underlying condition before removing that calcium deposits because this is very notorious for reoccurrence. The local treatment what we can give for the band-shaped keratopathy for patient to get comfortable is the chelation with a neutral solution of disodium ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, EDTA. So this percentage, it's like around 0.5% to 1.5% for 1 to 5 minutes. This is given in literature that different the surgeon has their own preference for this percentage. I use around 1% for 2 minutes. And you can use multiple time. I will show you the video to show how we are using EDTM. The phototherapeutic keratectomy using excimer laser for residual opacification after initial EDTA chelation. Usually what happens when you do EDTA, we remove the calcium deposits. But after that also your cornea is not smooth. So it affects the visual quality. So when you do PTK, it smoothens your cornea and it removes the remnant or residual opacification. So for the visual rehabilitation, this process can be done in combination. So this is a video which I want to show you here. So this is band-shaped in the silicon oil. This is a EDTA vacutainer, which so many people use here. Otherwise, the powder can be used. And the first step is to remove the unhealthy epithelium. Usually this epithelium is very loose and it will go off very, very easily. Suppose if it is not going off very easily, you can use alcohol delamination process also to remove this. The 20% of alcohol can be used for 20 seconds. So once we are removing this epithelium with the 15 number blade, then you can use Miro cells with the EDTA and try to rub cornea with the EDTA and give it some time for chelation to happen. 2 minutes is a good time. This video is fast forwarding because the limited time. So you can see how clear cornea becomes after EDTA chelation. So that's how we do it in the in our minor OT, or you can do it in the operation theater, whatever you feel like. Yeah. So EDTA is a very safe process. It's a reliable method. It's a first line treatment for the dense band shape keratopathy, which is affecting your vision. So improvement in the visual acuity and the ocular comfort, it's very important. It can be used in isolation or supplemented with superficial keratectomy or PTK or amniotic membrane transplant, which we already discussed about. Yeah. So another degeneration which we find in clinical practice is Salzmann nodular degeneration. It's a rare, non-inflammatory, slowly progressive degenerated condition. Usually the cause is chronic corneal inflammation or irritation, and the risk factors are chronic ocular condition like interstitial keratitis, vernal keratoconjunctivitis, post-viral keratitis, dry eye, meibomian gland dysfunction, blepharitis, pterygium, contact lens wear, and the previous trauma or the surgical procedures. So any ocular condition which is chronic can give rise to Salzmann nodular degeneration. So what are the characteristics? It shows a female predilection and usually happen between 5 to 6 decades of life, and common in Caucasian race, usually bilateral in 50% of the cases. It looks like a bluish or whitish gray corneal opacity, round conical prismatic or the wedge shape opacities. They are 1 to 8 in number. This number is taken from the literature, but I have seen asymmetrical Salzmann nodule which are not present like a small nodule. So that is called asymmetrical. And they are around 1 to 3 millimeter in size. They usually deposits are anterior to Bowman's layer, and they are concentrated more in the peripheral cornea rather than central and superior inferior cornea. They're usually avascular. And the location of the Salzmann can indicate the etiology of the disease. For example, when we remove pterygium, the Salzmann nodule usually formed by the edge of the blood vessels. In case of contact lens wear, the interpalpebral region is the most common area where Salzmann nodule were formed because of the landing zone of the contact lens. In keratoconus, the apex of the cornea is the most common site for Salzmann degeneration. So why it is important? It is important because if it is not asymptomatic, it will give you foreign body sensation. And of course, when it is central or when the peripheral nodules are multiple, it can give you decreased vision. So that's very important degeneration to take care of. Again, the ASOCT helps you to know what is the depth of the lesion. It's like a prominent hyperreflective subepithelial deposit overlying Bowman's membrane. The corneal opacities are located under a normally reflective thin epithelium. So it means that epithelium is pretty normal and the deposit is under the normal epithelium. The intraepithelial fibrosis overgrowth can result in corneal surface elevation above Bowman layer. So when Salzmann nodular degeneration is chronic, then it will start intraepithelial fibrosis. So the destruction of Bowman's layer is the most important property in the pathophysiology of the disease. It is replaced by the granular periodic acid shift positive eosinophilic material. The progression is determined by the Bowman's layer destruction. The involvement of Bowman's layer indicates that surgical delamination of the nodule may be more difficult. Because if it is deeper, you might hurt the stroma while we are removing it. So corneal tomography is again a very important tool which can assess the degree of irregularity and astigmatism caused by Salzmann degeneration and evaluate the improvement in regularity and astigmatism after surgical intervention. For example, this case, the best corrected visual acuity is around 20 by 30 and the refraction is around -1.25 to +3 at 93 degree. But after 7 weeks after superficial keratectomy, nodule removal, PTK and the intraoperative mitomycin C application, the BCV is still 20 by 30, but if you can see the refraction decreases like to -1 plus 0.5 cylinder at 95. So tomography also reveals, this is a comparative tomography which reveals a difference in the kind of astigmatism. The astigmatism was pretty irregular before the SK, but now after SK 7 week, it shows very regular astigmatism. So this is very important to give a regular surface for the better vision. So management. If it is peripheral and only foreign body sensation is the, and it is peripheral and flat and the foreign body sensation is the only symptom patient has, you can very well go for the conservative management. That is, you can go for ocular lubrication, warm compresses, lid hygiene. Short course of topical corticosteroid usually help to decrease the inflammation associated with the nodule, and the oral doxycycline will help. If they are raised nodules, nodules in the central visual axis causing reduced vision or failure of conservative management, we should always go for the surgical option. Like the last picture I showed, the superficial keratectomy. Along with that, we can use PTK or the lamellar keratoplasty in case of very severe Salzmann nodule degeneration. So these intervention can be coupled with alcohol-assisted delamination, amniotic membrane transplantation, and intraoperative mitomycin C. Again, the spheroidal degeneration is a condition which we call it by various names like Labrador keratopathy, Fisherman's keratopathy, climatic droplet keratopathy, actinic, and Betis band-shaped nodule. You call it anything, but very common name is spheroidal degeneration, which we all remember, I guess. So yeah, so degeneration of the cornea or the conjunctiva, it involves both cornea and conjunctiva. Higher prevalence in the area where extreme temperatures are there, like low humidity, high wind, presence of sand, high level of exposure to ultraviolet radiation. It has male predilection in the ratio of 7:3. So it is divided into primary spheroidal degeneration. It is attributed to aforementioned risk factor and is not associated with any ocular pathology. The secondary one occurs secondary to ocular inflammation and the corneal pathology. And the tertiary spheroidal degeneration associated with conjunctival finding and more frequently associated with pingicula. Usually it is bilateral. It involves peripheral cornea. They are coalescence in nature. They're nodular. They spread to involve the central cornea. Amber colored, it's homogeneous, translucent spherules varying in size. And the level of deposits are corneal stroma, Bowman's membrane, and subepithelium. The management is conservative, like we have to prevent patients from ultraviolet light. We can give them lubricating drop for symptomatic relief. And the surgical therapy is again very common because patients are usually very symptomatic. So patient with the corneal scarring and globules involving the anterior central part of the cornea, compromising vision or causing pain, may require surgical intervention like superficial keratectomy, phototherapeutic keratectomy, lamellar or penetrating keratoplasty in case, these keratoplasty depends upon the condition of the cornea. And the prognosis is like long-standing keratopathy may lead to visual impairment caused by involvement of visual axis due to secondary scarring. So if you have your patient has secondary scarring post spheroidal degeneration, and if you do superficial keratectomy or PTK, the scarring will still affect the vision. In such cases, you can go for lamellar or penetrating keratoplasty as well. Tearens marginal degeneration is again a slowly progressive, non-ulcerative thinning of the peripheral cornea. It is usually bilateral but asymmetric. Male predilection is observed. It happens in third to fifth decade of life. The exact etiology is unknown. The pathology has been associated with arthritis and meibomian gland dysfunction. So what happens here? It begins superonasally and progresses circumpharyngeally. Lipid deposition at the edge of peripheral corneal thinning. And there is a lipid accumulation produces a yellow-white stromal opacity like we are seen in this picture. And superficial neovascularization is the rule in this condition. So there is a intact corneal epithelium and altered Bowman's layer, a distinctive clear interval between the limbus and the site of infiltration you can see. And ultimately the stromal degeneration occurred causing formation of peripheral gutter. So one very important thing about this degeneration is that epithelium is always intact and the location is usually superior to start from superior condition, but it is crescentric in nature. It can cover 360 degree of cornea with age. And corneal perforation rate is 15%, which is pretty high. So we should always follow up these patients. So the two types. One is classic variant, which is very common. It affects the older population, usually asymptomatic, non-inflammatory, and slow and chronic progression. The another variant is an inflammatory variant, which can happen in young patient, or it affects any age, but usually common in young patient, more prominent inflammatory clinical course. It evolves very fast. Hypersensitivity responses to the immunogenic component of the basal membrane considered as the cause of it. So thinning of peripheral cornea, corneal opacification, neovascularization, and possible positive fluorescein staining are typical signs of the inflammatory type. Why it is important? Because it induces irregular corneal astigmatism, which is capable of reducing your visual acuity. It increases the higher order aberrations. So if you can see this tomography, you can see the irregular astigmatism, and you can see the superior thinning of the cornea. So ASOCT, again, is a very good tool to assess such patients. It takes a precise and repeatable pachymetry measurements. We can follow patient with ASOCT to see how much thinning happening with time, compare the size of lesion during follow-up, and the medical visits are recommended every 3 months when the minimal corneal thickness is 250 micron, because as I already said that 15% is the rate of corneal perforation in this anterior margin degeneration. So when we see ASOCT, we can see this thinning areas in the peripheral cornea. And we can, when we want to follow up this patient with OCT, we should have a serial OCT to compare with. So classic versus inflammatory tenens margin degeneration. The classic one has stroma, has the same reflectivity as a normal cornea. But in case of inflammatory one, there's a hyperreflectivity in the stroma because of inflammation. And why there's a hyperreflectivity? Because of the keratocytes, activation. So progressive stromal thinning induces corneal cavity formation with the intact epithelium and the endothelial layers around the lesion. So very important part, because we need to differentiate this condition from other peripheral corneal ulcerations. So the epithelium is always intact in this condition. The management is a non-surgical intervention. We can use spectacle, we can give rigid gas permeable lenses or scleral contact lens, because Tenens margin degeneration will give you irregular astigmatism. So soft contact lens or toric contact lens might not help such patient. So specialty lenses like RGP, scleral contact lens, CSCL, these kind of lenses are more helpful for these patients. Another important thing which you might have heard about is PROS lenses. They are prosthetic replacement of ocular surface ecosystem. It's a kind of scleral lens only, and it is customized according to the patient cornea. So it works very well in case of irregular astigmatism. We should always ask patient to avoid eye rubbing in such cases because of the thinning of the cornea. The surgical procedure are considered when the corneal thickness decreases to 150 micron. I must say that if the patient is very stable and you don't find any activity, there is no inflammatory activity, we should wait. We should not go for any surgical treatment until patient is symptomatic. 150 is the number which is given in the literature, which is depend upon the surgeon's experience. So I have written that number, we should know about it. But sometime at 150 micron also patient is very stable. So we should not do any surgery in such cases until we find that, you know, the cornea is having impending perforation or inflammation is too high. So the surgery can be categorized into tectonic surgeries, like we can just give the support to the impending perforation in form of conjunctival flaps, scleral autotransplantation, amniotic membrane grafting. Collagen cross-linking can be done in such patient to tighten the covalent bonds and to increase the covalent bonding. And the vision enhancing surgery plus tectonic surgery consists of epikeratophakia, lamellar keratoplasty, penetrating keratoplasty. So these surgeries can be done in case where we need to go for the visual rehabilitation for the patient as well as to control the impending perforation. Another important degeneration is a pellucid margin degeneration, which we find in our clinical practice very often. The word pellucid means clear, denotes the clarity of the cornea in this condition, despite of the presence of ectasia. It's a rare condition, idiopathic. thinning disorder of peripheral cornea in a crescentic fashion. It's inferior. It is. It usually cover inferior quadrant. And as literature says that PMD, keratoconus, and keratoglobus are believed to be distinct disease or the phenotypic variation of the same disorder. It has male predilection and it usually found in second to fifth decade of life. It's a bilateral condition. There's a narrow band of corneal thinning around 1 to 2 millimeter in width, which extend from 4 o'clock to 8 o'clock position in the cornea. The degree of thinning is usually severe. Up to 80% of stromal tissue loss happen. And again, the epithelium is intact in this degeneration. There's a clear interval of 1 or 2 millimeter from the limbus. Corneal protrusion most marked, superior to the area of thinning. So if you can see in this picture, the area of thinning is here, but the cornea is protruded above the thinning. So the corneal tomography is a gold standard to diagnose this disease. If you can see in the curvature map, there's a crab claw appearance. It shows the curvature is steep in the peripheral cornea. And if you can see the elevation map, front and back elevation, because you have already covered pentacam and corneal tomography, we can discuss this here. So this is called a three touch points. So all the three points are correlating here. And this is the clear picture of PMD. So there are other degeneration to which we have to differentiate pellucid margin degeneration from the keratoconus and keratoglobus. The most important thing is the location of protrusion. So in case of pellucid margin degeneration, the protrusion is superior to the thinning as we discussed already. This is thinning area and the protrusion is above this thinning area. It is called bare belly sign. And in keratoconus, usually the thinning happens at the apex where the thinning is, the protrusion is where the thinning is. In case of keratoglobus, there's a generalized globular protrusion. And if you see the tomography, you can differentiate both the condition very well. In pellucid margin degeneration, you have peripheral thinning and steepening. And in keratoconus, it is a paracentral disease. So these are the very important differentiating factor between these three degenerations. So the location, as we discussed, that PMD is usually affect inferior cornea, keratoconus affect central and paracentral cornea, and anterior marginal degeneration affects superior cornea. Though with time, the PMD and TMD affect 360 degree of cornea with time. So corneal thickness usually doesn't, the central corneal thickness doesn't change with PMD and TMD, but keratoconus has an effect on central corneal thickness as well. Corneal sensitivity part may decrease and in keratoconus and TMD, and the walk striae are only present in the keratoconus. The flesher ring is present in keratoconus, which is absent in TMD and TMD. And the vascularization is present in anterior margin degeneration, but it is absent in PMD and keratoconus. Lipid deposit is a very common feature of anterior margin degeneration, which is not very common in pellucid or keratoconus unless they ulcerate. If they ulcerate, usually secondary lipid deposition can happen in pellucid margin degeneration and keratoconus as well. So coming to the conjunctival degeneration, so the first very important degeneration, why it is important? Because it's very, very common. Everyone has seen like many in their clinical practice. It's a nodule of bulbar conjunctival thinning. It is paralimbal at 3 to 9 o'clock position. It is usually unilateral or it can be unilateral or bilateral, more common in the nasal than temporal. The nodule consists of hyaline and collagen elastic tissue. The theory is the ultraviolet radiation does elastotic degeneration of the conjunctival substantia propria, that's a stroma of the conjunctiva, and result in pinguiculum. It looks like elevated, it is yellow-white lesion. It do not invade the cornea, and there are few vessels, if any, usually there's no blood vessels, and it gives you foreign body sensation and the dryness in the eye. When the lesion become red and inflamed, it's called pinguiculitis. This is a picture which is showing the inflamed pinguicula. The prophylaxis is again the same because etiology says that UV rays are responsible for this. We should advise patient for UV protection. Protection from chronic wind and dust exposure. The treatment is again artificial tear. If patient is coming with pinguiculitis, a short-term course of topical vasoconstrictor or topical steroids are beneficial. Surgical excision can be done when the lesion is inflamed, unresponsive to conservative management, or if there is a cosmetic concern. So pingicula are associated with 2 to 3-fold increase incidence of ARMD, possibly through a common light exposure effect. So as in ARMD, also we say that the UV radiation is responsible factor. So maybe the same reason it says when the pingicula is there, that patient has 2 to 3 times more risk for developing ARMD. Okay. So now the, again, very common conjunctival degeneration, which involves cornea as well, is pterygium. And the pterygium means a little wing in Greek language. It's a wing-shaped vascular fleshy growth that originates on the conjunctiva and that can spread to the corneal limbus and beyond. A pterygium consists of 3 distinct parts. The cap or the leading edge is a flat zone on the cornea that consists mainly of fibroblasts that invades and destroy Bowman's membrane. The head is a vascular area that lies behind the cap and is firmly attached to the cornea. And the body or the tail is a mobile area of the bulbar conjunctiva, which can easily be dissected from the underlying tissue. So it is slowly progressive. It is a degenerative conjunctival changes. It's a fibrovascular. And the risk factor are ultraviolet light exposure, dust, drying, dry weather, or windy environment. Usually bilateral, uncommonly unilateral, more in the nasal conjunctiva than temporal and bilimbal. It reduces the vision by inducing astigmatism or introduction of the or obstruction of the visual axis. Patients are symptomatic. They have redness, irritation, foreign body sensation, photophobia, contact lens intolerance, and the cosmetic concerns are the bigger concern in case of pterygium. So again, in this picture, we can see this whitish opacity named islets of woe can be found on the surface of many pterygium. And very important spot question for the resident is the Stalker's line. It's a linear deposit of the iron may be seen on the cornea at the leading edge of the pterygium is called Stalker's line. So this yellowish line, it is deposits of iron, and usually these questions are asked by the examiner during your residency exam. So yeah, it's very important to differentiate pterygium from other diagnoses, because pterygium is not always found on the cornea and conjunctiva. It can be pure conjunctival lesion sometimes, and with time it cover cornea. So it should be differentiated from episcleritis. Episcleritis is again the inflammation of episclera. The differentiating feature are episcleritis is painful, it is inflamed, and it has a very short history, or it has an acute attack history. So you can differentiate patient from episcleritis. Then there's a bedot spot, which usually happen by after the vitamin A deficiency. And the patient would have other signs of vitamin A deficiency as well. And it is not a vascularized thing. And we should differentiate conjunctival intraepithelial neoplasia from pterygium. So usually the rule is that if you're removing pterygium from any patient's eye, it should always go for the pathological diagnosis to rule out this pterygium or any other benign or malignant lesion. Okay. So the treatment. What are the indication of surgery? So visually significant induced astigmatism is the first very important indication for the surgery. Threat of involvement of the visual axis. Suppose your pterygium is small, but still it is growing, fleshy. It can involve your visual axis. So it is important to remove it on time, because if you remove it later, it will leave some scar and it affect the patient's vision. So it's important to remove the pterygium before it involves the visual axis. There's a severe symptoms of irritation, then we should remove. And the cosmetic concern are very important for the patient. So for that concern also, we remove the pterygium. So surgical techniques, very common is Baird sclera technique, in which we just remove the pterygium and leave the Baird sclera. The only limitation of the surgery is it will not stop the recurrence of the pterygium. The pterygium is a recurrent degenerative disorder. So usually it recur very fast. And the best part of the surgery, it is fast surgery. You can do it without anesthesia. You can just remove the pterygium and patient is discharge within 15 minutes. But then the recurrence is very high. So the surgery which is accepted by all surgeons is a conjunctival autograft technique. In this, we take the conjunctiva from the superior part of the patient's eye and remove the pterygium and put the graft on the bad sclera. Usually the recurrence is decreased considerably in these cases. The third part is amniotic membrane grafting. This is very important. Suppose if you have a bilimbal pterygium, in such cases, we don't have enough conjunctiva to cover the autograft to cover these lesions with. So we can use amniotic membrane grafting. And second most important reason, if the patient is glaucomatous and you expect that patient might go for trabeculectomy in future and we don't want to disturb the superior conjunctiva, we usually use amniotic membrane grafting in such cases. So adjunctive therapies which we use with the surgical techniques are mitomycin C and the beta irradiation. Why we use these adjunctive therapies? Because pterygium is notorious for recurrence. So when we use mitomycin C and beta irradiation, it decreases the fibroblast activities and in turn it reduces the recurrence of the pterygium. But these adjuvant therapies, they have their own side effects, like they can melt sclera. So we have to be very cautious when we are using this, and the patient should be under follow-up. So concretion is again very common conjunctival degeneration which we find, and it's like a chalky white to yellow. It's a keratin and epithelial debris containing cyst located in the fornix or inferior or superior palpebral conjunctiva. Increasing age and the chronic inflammation is considered to be the reason for concretion. Erosion through the overlying conjunctiva can cause the foreign body sensation. So if it is covered with the conjunctiva, it is real mostly asymptomatic. But if it erode the superficial epithelium and it start scratching your cornea, then it is the patient is very, very symptomatic with concretions. It may be secondary, as in late stage of trachoma. In case of any chronic inflammation, concretion can happen. So what I do for concretion, it's like just one clinical pearl. So when I find a lot of concretion in my patient, I usually stain my patient with fluorescein dye. And if those concretions are staining positive, that means the epithelium is missing from the top of concretion. So they are the reason for the foreign body sensation. Such concretion should be removed. But suppose there are less concretion and the fluorescein staining is negative, that means it is nicely epithelized and patient is not complaining anything, then we can always leave this concretion and put patient on lubricating medications so that patient will be comfortable. Conjunctival calluses. This is again a redundancy of the bulbar conjunctiva between the globe and the lower eyelid margin. Theorized to be due to the blockage of lymphatic flow causing lymphatic dilatation and eventual conjunctival elastosis and redundancy. Again, it is a senile changes, and patient will present with ocular irritation, pain, sometimes subconjunctival hemorrhages, epiphora, dry eye, ulceration. A very important part we have to notice, sometime when you see patient with conjunctival calluses, which is usually inferior or small, we always miss that diagnosis. And when we see the patient, we always see that there's nothing in the eye. So always make a habit of checking the conjunctiva and always check the snap sign in the lower lid. If there's a laxity of the lower lid, there's a conjunctival calluses. Sometimes we keep giving patients some medications and we don't even know what is the reason for the complaints. So conjunctival calluses is a very, very common reason for patient in old age when they're coming after cataract surgery and they are telling you that it is like foreign body sensation is very bad. So usually we miss this thing and this should be addressed. So the treatment should be artificial tear, lubricating gel, sometimes corticosteroid antihistamines for the vasoconstriction, and the nocturnal patching can help. Surgery can be performed in case of very symptomatic patient, and that can be, we can remove the redundant conjunctiva, and the good conjunctiva, we can just use the glue and stick back to the globe, or we can use amniotic membrane grafting for such patients. So I think I came to the end of my talk. I'm ready to take any questions. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. You really covered it very extensively. We have few questions. Rolika will be taking them. Mm-hmm. Rolika?
Hello, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Can I stop sharing my screen or let it be like this?
Yes, ma'am, you can stop sharing it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, ma'am. So the question is that, is there a concurrence of Xanthalasma and Arcus juvenilis?
So actually Xanthalasma is an age-related changes which can happen without high cholesterol level also. It's again the aging degeneration. It might not be associated with a pathological degeneration always. So it can be associated with high cholesterol, but high cholesterol is not always the reason for that. But arcus juvenilis usually happen when you have any coronary artery or the hyperlipoproteinemia. So yeah, it can occur together, but it's not. Xanthalasma, again, the senility is not pathological always.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, is there a correlation of band-shaped keratopathy with VKH?
See, again, I covered that point. I just in my presentation also, I said, any chronic ocular condition which affect the ocular surface, be it VKH or VKC or any eye condition, suppose VKH is causing any kind of ocular disorders, or suppose the patient is going for the retinal surgeries again and again because of VKH, right? So the number of surgeries which affect the ocular surface and band-shaped keratopathy can happen.
Okay, ma'am. How much of visual gain is expected in patients with silicon oil-induced band-shaped keratopathy when we do PTK?
Okay, so again, the PTK or EDTA chelation, they are for removing the bands, okay? And if the surgery is done for what kind of retinal pathology, that depends. Suppose if the retina is absolutely normal after silicon oil and if it is done for detachment and retina is totally attached, if we remove the bands, then the vision recovery depends upon the retinal potency, right? Because this PTK and EDTA remove the full band. Your surface is very, very clean and clear. So now the vision depends upon the retina, not on the cornea.
Correct, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And ma'am, what is the treatment of choice in patients with band-shaped keratopathy with a component of endogenous uveitis?
Okay, so when you have endogenous uveitis, usually we treat that first. So once the patient is silent and there is no inflammatory activity, we treat the patient. Usually in case of band-shaped keratopathy, if we do plain PTK, patient will not be happy because we all know that the cornea is very rough and irregular. So what we have to do, like what I am doing in my clinical practice, I do EDTA chelation first, remove all the bands, and then I do the PTK for smoothing of the cornea. So this is the process which I follow, and most of my colleagues and most of the surgeon I know, they follow the same process. And when the inflammation is there, I try not to touch patient until the inflammation is silent.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, how to prevent the occurrence of herpes zoster keratitis induced band-shaped keratopathy, like in patients who are already being treated for herpes zoster?
See, if you make your surface smoother and moist, usually band-shaped keratopathy is not a very common occurrence. And again, the band-shape is not dependent upon the etiology like herpes or VKH or uveitis. It depends upon the kind of surface you have. Any disorder which makes your ocular surface rough is prone for the band-shaped keratopathy. There is no prediction that herpes will have dense band-shaped keratopathy. Usually uveitis have a dense keratopathy, but it depends upon the type of ocular surface these diseases will leave after they are, treated.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, what is the mechanism of deposition of calcium in band-shaped keratopathy, and why is it only horizontal?
So it depends upon the intraparotid region. Why? Because the intraparotid region, where the tears are pooling in. And then it is an environmental factor, and the calcium from the environment deposit where the tears will pool. And depends upon the exposed cornea, where the collagens are loose. Usually the deposits will happen in those areas. So if you see any chronic inflammation, the changes are usually in the horizontal area because the exposed part collagen is only affected. So that is why it happens.
Okay, ma'am. Why Flesher ring is formed only in keratoconus and not in PMD?
Actually, Flesher ring is formed at the apex of the, at the base of the cone, right? And the PMD doesn't have a cone. It is like when the cone is formed in the keratoconus, there is an area which is at the base of the cone. There's a dipping of the cornea. And the dipping, when the tears are pooling, those iron will deposit. But that same thing is not happening in PMD. The PMD will also have pigmentary deposit, but not in the form of Flesher ring. So it's like very characteristics of keratoconus.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, one of the hot seat participants has asked that what are the ophthalmic medications with phenylmercuric nitrate which cause band-shaped keratopathy?
So we don't use any right now. We use silver nitrate before, for ophthalmia neonatrum and all. But I don't know any which we use right now because these things are written in literature. We always put it in the talks, but none of the medicine I know which we are using.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, in a patient with keratoconus, which is the commonest corneal degeneration that we will be seeing?
In patient with, sorry, I did not get the question.
In a patient with keratoconus, which is the commonest form of corneal degeneration that can occur?
So keratoconus itself is a corneal degeneration. I don't understand. You wanted to know what are the secondary changes happening?
Secondary changes.
So you see secondary degeneration because it is again an iron deposit. So this is like a deposit in the cornea. And this is the most common thing which happens with keratoconus.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, the collagen cross-linking in keratoconus, it helps in reducing the possibility of secondary degenerations or aggravates it, ma'am?
So actually, keratoconus itself is a degeneration, I must say, first of all. And it is not covered in this talk because it is already covered in ectatic degeneration. So collagen cross-linking will regularize your cornea more. It will decrease the conical shape of the cornea. So it usually decreases any kind of other pigmentary changes which will happen in the conical cornea. So it is usually making your cornea more regular and more convex. So if I answer that question, it will decrease all the pathological thing happening with keratoconus.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, EDT can be used in all forms of band-shaped keratopathy or only in hypercalcemia-caused one?
No, actually, hypercalcemia is a level of calcium in your blood. But the result, band-shaped keratopathy can happen because of multiple reasons and it can be treated by EDTA. By any etiology, it happens. EDTA is the first line of treatment for band-shaped keratopathy.
Okay, ma'am. Is it feasible to consider intacts with the refractive lenticule implantation in the management of pellucid marginal degeneration?
So intacts, we cannot see. It's very, very simple thing. Like if you go by the science, pellucid marginal degeneration is a peripheral disorder, right? And there is a protrusion above thinning. And what intacts does is a mechanical stretching of the cornea. And we cannot put intacts in the periphery. We have to put intacts in the paracentral region. So if you put intacts in pellucid marginal degeneration, it will not distribute the force systematically, right? So usually we don't put intacts in pellucid margin. It can only be put in the central or paracentral ectatic degeneration, not in the peripheral degeneration.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, and one last question would be that are pterygium and meibomian gland disease clinically correlated?
Sorry?
Are pterygium and MGD clinically correlated?
Actually, I must say that the etiology behind pterygium is considered to be the UV radiation. But UV radiation causes many other problems in the eye. So meibomian gland directly not related with the UV radiation, but obviously it can happen. So I don't know any clinical correlation which directly relate these two conditions. But yeah, indirectly they may be.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you for answering all our questions, ma'am, and thank you for the lovely presentation.
Thank you for having me, guys. And you can post your question on my email. I would love to answer all the questions possible. And
Ma'am, I have a doubt. Ma'am, like, what's the reason behind the band-shaped keratopathy in silicone oil, ma'am?
usually what happens when you, I mentioned that silicon oil in aphagic patient, right?
Yes, so
usually what happens when the silicon oil is in their aphagic patient is usually the corneal irritation, and it indirectly denudes the surface also. So, and then, yeah, sorry.
Sorry, ma'am. It was like the voice was breaking. It wasn't.
I don't know. My internet is just nasty right now. I don't know. Maybe things are not over. Yeah, so usually the multiple surgery and the chronic condition is the reason which affect your ocular surface. So silicon oil is usually put in the cases where the retinal disorders are there, long surgery happened, and the patient is aphagic. So usually it affects your surface as well. And when it affects the surface, so when the surface is unhealthy, any deposits can happen on that.
What's the reason behind subconjunctival hemorrhage and conjunctival calasis, ma'am?
Usually what happens, it is a loose conjunctiva, right? Loose conjunctiva, when any vessel bleed, the blood will deposit in that. That's why. And loose conjunctiva keep getting mechanical hurts while you're blinking. Can happen. It's not a very common finding. It written literature, I mentioned that because for the resident it's important to know everything, but it is not a very common finding for us.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
It may happen. Yes, Dr. Jiva.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful session.
Thank you for having me, guys. Thank you a lot.
Yeah. It's wonderful having you here with us, ma'am, today. Thank you, everyone. So please join for the next session, that is on October 23rd. And we have Dr. Samar Basak, who will be speaking on eye banking and corneal preservation techniques. Thank you so much. Good night.